Hey guys, this topic is all about homeostasis and control, part of your Edexcel biology. If you want to follow along with this, make sure you're not missing anything else, make sure you've got all the key points. You can do that by getting the free revision guide, which is over on my website.
Here we have the male and female endocrine system, the pituitary gland. Is in the brain, thyroid is in the neck, the adrenal glands are in the kidneys, pancreas is hiding behind the stomach, ovaries are kind of like hip level, and testes hang below the penis. The testes produce testosterone, which has the effect of growing muscles, making the balls and penis drop and grow larger, increasing the rate of hair growth. Estrogen is produced in the ovaries, that's responsible for the maturation of eggs and the menstrual cycle. The pancreas produces insulin, which is important for regulating blood glucose levels. The adrenal glands produce adrenaline, which is important for our fight or flight response. The thyroid produces thyroxine, which is important in regulating our metabolism. The pituitary gland is very busy. Among other things, it produces follicle stimulating hormone, FSH, and luteinizing hormone, LH. One of the reasons periods feel so rubbish is because your hormones are literally all over the place. Starting with follicle stimulating hormone, it rises, peaks, and its job is to make the small egg grow up to a larger egg and then be released. Luteinizing hormone is only active for a very, very short period. Its job is to release the egg. Estrogen builds up until it stimulates luteinizing hormone. Progesterone builds up slowly as it builds up the lining of the uterus. And if there is no if there is no embryo implanted in it, that will decrease and the lining of the uterus will break down. There are a number of different methods of contraception, some hormonal, some non-hormonal, that will stop you getting pregnant. But not all of these will protect against sexually transmitted diseases, so it's always very, very important that you wear a condom. This is a barrier method of contraception. This will stop the sperm getting the woman pregnant, and it will also stop any nasties that are occurring between transmitted from her to him or from him to her. The pill and the coil, IUD, intrauterine device, are hormonal methods of stopping getting pregnant. They're going to stop the egg being released or the egg being implanted. The diaphragm is a barrier method because it will stop sperm entering the vagina, but the semen will still be transferred into the vaginal entrance so that you can still get sexually transmitted diseases this way. If you're sure that you don't want to have children, you can let go to be sterilised, you can have a vasectomy, you can have your tubes tied, which will mean that no sperm will get from the testes out to the penis, or for the woman, no egg will be released. Around 1 in 6 people will find themselves in the unfortunate position where they can't have children naturally. About half this is due to male-related reasons and half this is due to female-related reasons. As you can see, I am one of those people, and last year, 2016, we did IVF, and this is my massive bump. So the obvious advantages for IVF are you get a baby out of it, and if you've been in a situation where you can't have something that you really, really want, you know, it's very, very sad and affects your mental health quite a lot. So having a baby is going to be good for people that want to have a baby, their mental health. However, the disadvantages are you have to take a large, large number of drugs for a very, very long period of time. These have very nasty side effects. As well as the daily injections, which leave you horribly bruised. There are long-term consequences for these. because taking these IVF drugs increases your chance of various different types of cancer. It is very expensive. I had to have it twice. That's twice as expensive. Doesn't always work. There is about a 40% success rate with IVF, with each round of IVF costing a minimum £5,000, with a 40% success rate. Here are the large number of drugs that I had to take day by day. It's a very costly, time-consuming, painful process. Homeostasis is the maintenance of a constant internal environment. And to keep your body functioning properly, we need to control our blood glucose levels, our water levels, and our temperature. The brain is the control center. And that's going to be sending signals to various parts of the body. For example, to the pancreas, which is responsible for producing insulin. Effector muscles are going to do things like moving, for example, shivering. And then glands are going to be responsible for the production of other hormones. Body temperature is going to be regulated by the thermoregulatory center in the brain. If you are too cold, the hairs on your body will stand up. This is to trap a layer of air. You're going to stop sweating. Vasoconstriction will start. So your blood vessels will constrict so that they're further away from the skin. Less blood is going to flow close to the surface of the skin, so less heat is going to be lost from it. And your muscles are going to start to shiver, and movement is going to produce energy. If you are too hot, your hairs are going to lie flat, so they're not trapping any air. You're going to start sweating. And the water is going to evaporate, leading to heat and energy loss. And your blood vessels are going to undergo vasodilation, meaning they're going to get wider so that blood can flow closer to the surface of the skin so that heat can be lost. The kidneys have three functions. They remove urea. They control the iron content and they control the water content of the blood. There are three ways we can lose water from our body: in urine, in sweat, and when we breathe. It's important to control the level of water in the body because there's too much water, it's too much water taken up by cells by osmosis, then they might pop, or if there's not enough water, then the enzymes, the functions, the reactions won't be able to take place. There are three steps to the way that the kidneys function: ultrafiltration, reabsorption, and then the release. Blood enters the kidneys under high pressure, and water, ions, urea, and sugar are going to be squeezed out into the capsule, which is at the start of the nephron. As this all flows along the nephron, useful things are reabsorbed. All of the sugar is going to be reabsorbed via active transport. Some ions, the amount of ions that we need, the type of ions that we need, are going to be reabsorbed by active transports. And enough water that we need is going to be reabsorbed. The hormone that controls how much water is going to be absorbed is ADH, which is antidiuretic hormone. And then anything that isn't reabsorbed is going to come out as wee. If kidneys aren't working properly, a person can undergo kidney dialysis. The dialysis machine will take over the function of the kidneys, but it is very time consuming, it takes about 4 hours and has to be done 3 times a week. So this has a huge impact on someone's life and is not a lot of fun. An alternative to dialysis could be a kidney transplant, but these come with very long waiting lists and there is always the risk of rejection. Control of blood glucose is very complicated. After a meal has been eaten, blood glucose levels start to rise. This is picked up by the pancreas. The pancreas produces insulin, which is sent out into the blood. The insulin in the bloodstream is going to cause body cells to start to remove glucose from the blood. Liver and muscle cells can take the glucose and convert it into glycogen and store it. Removing glucose from the blood will cause blood glucose levels to fall. If blood glucose levels get too low, this is also picked up by the pancreas. The pancreas will start to produce glucagon. The glucose that has previously been stored in muscle and liver cells starts to return to the blood. The most complicated part of this is getting all the names right. The stored form of glucose is glycogen. Glucagon will convert that into glucose. And this returning of the glucose will cause blood glucose levels to rise again. There are two different types of diabetes, type 1 and type 2. In type 1 diabetes, the pancreas doesn't work properly. So it doesn't produce the right amount of insulin. In type 2 diabetes, cells start to become insensitive to insulin. Symptoms for both are going to be a loss of weight. An increased need to wee. Being very thirsty. Blurry vision. Fatigue. So being very sleepy and hunger. Treatment for type 1 diabetes is going to involve insulin injections. Type 2 diabetes, it's going to be controlling diet. Exercise.